Anyway, you don't need me. I just play bass in the background. Nobody even remembers me.
Are you kidding? I don't need to tell you what you already know. You're the one with style. You're the whole darn show. The other guys play their instruments fine, but next to you, their looks are a crime.
Well, they say true beauty, it comes from within, but you have to be comfortable in your own skin. So I exfoliate with this exotic cream. Just look at me. I look like a dream.
You have to admit, it looks pretty darn good.
Candace, what is going on?
Tricycle!
Hello, Internet, and welcome to Behind the Meme, where we take a look at the meaning and the origin of your favorite memes. Today we have a look at You Reposted in the Wrong Neighborhood. I have been seeing and hearing You Reposted in the Wrong Neighborhood in various videos for weeks now. I didn't understand that it was a popular trend until I saw comments in my videos suggesting I do a video on the topic. Thank you all so very much for your suggestions. Keep them coming. Who knows, your suggestion may be the next video. You wanted it, now you have it. Here we go. So what exactly is You Reposted in the Wrong Neighborhood? When I first heard the title, I thought it might have something to do with some type of internet gangster. Some type of person who gets mad when you post something on the wrong website.
Hey, vato, you reposted in the wrong neighborhood, fool. This is the place where I post pictures of cats. You take your picture of a dog and get out of here, fool. This is my area.
Something kinda like that. But I was wrong. It's actually the title of a remixed song that has become a part of a trend here on YouTube. A trend that involves adding the song into various videos that are remixed in a variety of ways. The song is a remix of two other songs. The first song, which serves as the music of the remix, is a song by Glue70 called Cassin. The song that is used as the lyrics of You Reposted in the Wrong Neighborhood is Shake That by rapper Eminem featuring Nate Dogg.
To the one, from the one to the three, I like good and I like good trees. Smoke so much, you wouldn't believe, and I get more ass than a toilet seat.
Okay, so we have two songs that are decent separately, but really neither one of them is that amazing, at least in my opinion. But that all changes when you combine them together. When you do that, magic happens. Prepare your ears, they're about to hear something amazing.
Two to the one, from the one to the three. I like good pussy and I like good trees. Smoke so much weed you wouldn't believe, and I get more ass than a toilet seat.
This match made in music heaven was uploaded to the SoundCloud profile of an artist named Shock, spelled with two K's. Somebody didn't pass English class. The song was posted on March 24th, 2014, and today sits at over 2.5 million plays. Okay, so we understand how the song was created, but how and why has it become a video trend online? Well, those questions are easier to ask than answer. The first use of the song in remix videos is largely unknown, but in the description of the song on Shock SoundCloud, he points to this video that was uploaded on April 24th, 2015 as being the video that started it all.
Two to the one, from the one to the three. I like good pussy and I like good trees. Smoke so much weed you wouldn't believe, and I get more ass than a toilet seat.
This video's intention was to vent frustration because Steam had started to allow mod makers to sell mods for the game Skyrim, a practice that was typically free to everybody before. But in reality, instead of serving as a video to voice displeasure with the platform, it served as the launching pad of a popular internet trend. During the later part of 2015 and most of 2016, the trend started to spread. Soon the song began to appear in many other video remixes on YouTube, often accompanied with people or characters that seem to be dancing in tune with the feel-good music.
Two to the one, from the one to the three. I like good pussy and I like good trees. Smoke so much weed you wouldn't believe, and I get more ass than a toilet seat. Three to the one, from the one to the three. I met a bad bitch last night in the D. Let me tell you how I'm gonna leave.
My first exposure to the song happened when one of my favorite YouTubers, H3H3, Papa Bless to All, uploaded a video in which he reads mean comments with his mother. When he was asked just how great his moves truly were, he had to demonstrate to the world that indeed, they were great.
Heard motherfuckers talk, seen them drop. If I ain't got a weapon, I'ma pick up a rock. And when I bust your ass, I'm gonna continue to rock. Get your ass on the wall.
Wow, Ethan, great moves. Keep it up. Proud of you.
But the trend has continued to evolve. There are many videos who have begun to substitute the lyrics of the song with another song, creating a whole new remix in the process. But the final question still remains, why? Why this song? Why this trend? Why is it happening this way? Well, by now you must know that sometimes it's best to not question the internet. Sometimes things just happen. It starts off when one person sees another person do something that they enjoy and they themselves want to get in on the fun. At that point, things begin to spread and take off. There's not always a real reason to why it started in the first place. All that I know is that song is catchy. It makes you feel pretty damn good. People seem to enjoy hearing it, at least I know I do. And to top it off, it seems that almost any dance can go with it, even if it wasn't the original intention to be accompanied with that music. At the end of the day, it's just good old-fashioned fun, and everybody loves having fun. Unless you're an ISIS, I'm pretty sure those guys don't have fun. But hey, that's the internet for you, and on the internet, memes are king. Thank you all so very much for watching. Make sure to subscribe so you can catch my next video and stay up to date on all your favorite memes. Who knows, you may learn about a meme you never knew about before. I'll catch you guys next time.
Get your ass on the wall with your two left feet. It's real easy, just follow the beat. Don't let that fine girl pass you by.
Hello, internet, and welcome to Behind the Meme, where we take a look at the meaning and the origin of your favorite memes. Today we have a look at the Nut Shack. This topic has been highly requested by many of my viewers. When I first saw all the comments requesting this topic, I had no clue to what it was. I just thought everybody was into some strange type of porn. But luckily, I was wrong. Let me start this video off by saying this has to be one of the weirdest and strangest memes I have come across through all my time memeing. It's hard to explain, but I'm gonna give it my best shot. The Nut Shack is an animated sitcom that first aired on television in 2007. It is well known for two primary reasons. One, it was the first animated series that was geared towards a Filipino-American audience. And two, all across the internet, it is well known for being one of the worst animated television shows in history, often being critiqued for its poor quality, crude and juvenile humor, and bad voice acting. From what I saw of the show, there also seems to be a heavy emphasis on nuts and penis jokes, and I use the term joke lightly.
The next time I see you, your wrinkly nuts will be going down.
What did you say? You're going down on my nuts?
What? No.
So it's not really a surprise to learn that the show never really managed to gain a significant audience through its 16-episode and 2-season run. But surprisingly, in later years, it has gained an audience. Well, its theme song has at least. The theme song is widely considered to be one of the worst and most repetitive songs for a television show.
It's the Nut Shack. It's the Nut Shack.
As you might be able to tell, it isn't a very creative or complex song. The song itself was written by Filipino-American hip-hop artist Nump Trump, whose other work isn't too bad. I don't know what happened with him and the Nut Shack theme, but something tells me when he talks about his work, the first thing he mentions is not the Nut Shack. Anyways, like I was saying, in recent years the theme song has become very popular for its use online. Its use is very weird and strange, to say the least. What people have started doing the last few months is remixing the song in strange ways. For example, one variation has the song remixed in a way that every lyric appears in alphabetical order. There's even a version where the theme song is posh and elegant.
This general vicinity we live in has been nicknamed the Nut Shack. I can agree with that statement. This general vicinity we live in has been nicknamed the Nut Shack.
Strange stuff, right? Well, what if I told you it gets stranger? Well, it does. Some have even began to replace words with different videos entirely. It's kind of hard to explain. Basically, the video starts off normal, but when a word is said, typically a noun, a completely different video starts to play. Once the video is over, the original video continues. Crazy, right? What's even crazier is one specific use of this type of remix that has come to be known as Nutshack Edits involves the reading of the entire script from the B-movie. I'm not making it up. The video's total length is over 14 hours and has over 800,000 views. Not only that, but there are many variations of the Nutshack intro. All have a significant amount of views as well. The reasons to why this type of video has spread so quickly remains a mystery. My personal opinion is that people love to do wacky things. And when you have a horrible song that's so bad it's good, and you have a wacky type of way to edit it, it makes for internet gold. So it's safe to say, the Nutshack has had success. Just not in the way that the creators originally intended. But hey, that's the internet for you, and on the internet, memes are king. Thank you all so very much for watching. Make sure to subscribe so you can catch my next video and stay up to date on all your favorite memes. Who knows, you may learn about a meme you never knew about before. I'll catch you guys next time. Hello, internet, and welcome to Behind the Meme, where we take a look at the meaning and the origin of your favorite memes and trends. Today we have a look at Biggie Cheese. Biggie Cheese is a topic that many of my viewers have wanted to see a video on. I would like to take a moment to thank each and every single one of you for not only watching my video, but also leaving me comments letting me know what you wanted to see. Who knows, your request may be the next video. You wanted it, now you have it. Here we go. Biggie Cheese. No, it's not the new cheeseburger at McDonald's that clogs all your arteries, although it would be the perfect name for a cheeseburger. Instead, Biggie Cheese is this little fellow right here, or should I say big fellow. Biggie Cheese is the name of a mouse character that appeared in the 2006 computer animated film Barnyard. Huh? What, you didn't see it? Well, you kinda did, even if you didn't. You see, Barnyard is one of those generic ripoff films that basically copied Toy Story after Toy Story had huge success. Here's the plot of the film according to its IMDb page. Now tell me if it sounds familiar to you. When the farmer's away, all the animals play and sing and dance. Eventually though, someone has to step in and run things, a responsibility that ends up going to Otis, a carefree cow. Huh. That sounds like a movie I've seen, even though I haven't seen Barnyard. Except replace Farmer with Andy and Animals with Toys and Otis with Woody. Am I right? In the movie, Biggie Cheese has a small but memorable scene in which he performs the song Boombastic, which was a song released in 1995 by the artist Shaggy. Sykes. No, not that Shaggy. This Shaggy, who you probably never knew existed, or if you did, completely forgot about until now.
She called me Mr. Boombastic, tell me fantastic, touch me on me box, she says I'm Mr. Roll.
People eventually took the Biggie Cheese scene and started to remix it with various other songs other than Boombastic. And in recent weeks, he has even begun to be used in the popular word replacement videos here on YouTube. Biggie Cheese has also become a very popular figure on the website iFunny.com, with many images that can be found that are tagged with Biggie Cheese, often referring to Biggie Cheese as a godlike figure and amazing rapper in ironic ways. And in the world of ironic memes, Biggie Cheese is perfect. He's the right blend of random, comedy, and WTF. Now that's the background to who and what Biggie Cheese is, but there's one more reason to why he's become become so popular, a reason that's a bit more X-rated. So if you happen to be sensitive to sexual content that is extremely funny and weird, please skip ahead. If not, prepare for randomness beyond belief. You see, there is a subculture of people known as furries. Each person within the culture varies, but to some people, when it comes to sex, their turn-on is animals with human-like characteristics.
Whoa.
Typically, it's as simple as a person wearing an animal costume while having sex, but other times it's a bit more complicated. But the reason to why I'm talking about furries is because Biggie Cheese has been dragged into the world when he was used in a sexual roleplay scenario. Earlier this year on a Facebook page that is dedicated to exposing furries, they uploaded screenshots of a group text message which involved Biggie Cheese in a sexual fantasy. I will now play a part of a video that somebody uploaded in which they do a dramatic reading of the sexually explicit messages.
The two thrust at the same time, staring at each other. The eye contact is real and they know it. Biggie Cheese goes in for a high five. The male high fives him. The woman is below them, getting absolutely plowed, having the time of her life, thinking to herself, epic.
Can we all just agree that the internet is a strange place? You know, like, don't get me wrong, I love the internet, but sometimes I'm also afraid of it. So there you have it. Biggie Cheese started off as a minor character from a computer animated film and has turned into one of the greatest rap gods of our generation, who sometimes participates in strange sexual encounters. He's kind of like R. Kelly. But hey, that's the internet for you, and on the internet, memes are king. Thank you all so very much for watching. Make sure to subscribe so you can catch my next video and stay up to date on all your favorite memes. Who knows, you may learn about a meme you never knew about before. I'll catch you beautiful people next time.
Nigga, nigga, bitch, nigga, 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 fried chicken, nigga, watermelon, nigga, bitch, nigga, nigga, white women, please,
Hello, internet, and welcome to Behind the Meme, where we take a look at the meaning and the origin of your favorite memes and trends. Today we have a look at We Are Number One. This topic has been highly requested by many of my viewers. Lately, there has been an increase of requests for Lazy Town, Robbie Rodden, and We Are Number One. As always, thank you all so very much for your suggestions. I'm excited to get into this one. You wanted it, now you have it. Here we go. So this video is about three things, but one thing in particular. But to understand that one thing, I must first explain the two other topics. Trust me, it's not as confusing as I'm making it sound. To first understand the popular meme, We Are Number One, I must first explain Lazytown. What is Lazytown? Now at first, by the name of it, you may think it's a town full of stoners who just sit around and do nothing all day, but we're wrong.
This is the way it's been since she started smoking pot. She's all lazy and boring.
Lazytown is a musical children's television show from Iceland that first aired in 2004 on Nick Jr. The show promoted a healthy lifestyle and featured costumed actors, puppetry, and CGI animation. Also, some of the most catchy songs I have ever heard. Seriously, I bump this tune in my car when I'm feeling emo, and at the end of the car ride, I feel like Richard Effin Simmons.
I'm careful, can't you see? It's a piece of cake, it's like a pretty cake. If the way is hazy, you gotta do the cooking by the book. You know you can't be lazy, never use a messy recipe. The cake will end up crazy.
Okay, so you may be wondering, why am I listening to a guy on the internet talk about his emotional problems and a kid's television show? But it's because this children's show has spawned various memes and remixes from segments of the show, like this remix that I'm about to show you of the song that we just heard.
Crazy, if you do the cooking by the book, then you'll have a...
Break it down, bitch, let me see you back it up. Drop that ass down, load it, pick that motherfucker up. Break it down, bitch, let me see you back it up. Drop that ass down, load it, pick that motherfucker up.
Pretty badass, right? Well, now that we have an understanding of Lazytown, let's move on to the next subject, Robbie Rodden. What is that? No, not what. Who? This is Robbie Rodden. I know, his appearance is rather startling at first. And no, he isn't Jay Leno's son. I thought the same thing. Robbie is a character in Lazytown who is the main villain and enemy of the other characters. But what is it that makes Robbie so hated? Is it his hair gel bill that he runs up each and every month? No. Apparently, he tries to lead the citizens of Lazytown away from a healthy lifestyle. So basically, he's McDonald's, just with better hair and a stronger chin. Actually, Robbie is the reason to why I'm making this video in the first place. On October 3rd, 2014, the season 4, episode 12 of LazyTown aired, which was titled Robbie's Dream Team. In this episode, Robbie clones himself in the attempt to create the perfect team of villains, but his clones have a hard time learning the ins and outs of being evil. So what is an evil villain to do when his clones don't understand the concept of being evil? He attempts to teach them the lessons through song and dance. Duh. Aside from being humorous, strange, and looking like the creators of the show are on a ton of drugs, the song is also catchy as hell. I swear, this is a kid's show, but damn, the music is pretty cool. Believe it or not, I'm not the only person to think this. Since it first aired on television, the song and video have begun to appear online in a variety of remixes and memes. Drop it. One of the most notable remixes of the song came from Siva Gunner, which was released on September 13th, 2016, and has received over 350,000 views at the time of this video. Drop it. The song has also become very popular on SoundCloud, where it is often used in mashups known as SoundClowns. Each one being more random than the previous. But sadly, the show ended in 2014, putting an end to the catchy and humorous videos that eventually ended up on the internet. And in even sadder news, it became a trending topic in September of 2016, when it was announced that Stefan Karl, the actor who played Robbie Rawdon, was seriously ill and dealing with a tumor. Because of this unfortunate news, the popularity of Robbie Rawdon and We Are Number One has seen an increase in recent weeks. Let's all hope that he gets better quickly. So there you have it. A children's show with catchy songs that eventually made its way to the internet to become a popular meme that people love to share and listen to. But hey, that's the internet for you, and on the internet, memes are king. Thank you all so very much for watching. Make sure to subscribe so you can catch my next video and stay up to date on all your favorite memes. Who knows, you may learn about a meme you never knew about before. I'll catch you guys next time.
So what can I do for you, you incredibly handsome person? Thank you. I'd like an ice cream about this high.
That's what she said.
You're the one we all can see. It's all about you.
It's all about me.
Hello, internet, and welcome to Behind the Meme, where we take a look at the meaning and the origin of your favorite memes and trends. Today we have a look at the 1,000-degree knife. Now, this is a topic that has recently become relevant on YouTube within the last couple of weeks. I've had a handful of people request a video on the topic, so thank you all so very much for reaching out, letting me know what you wanted to see next. Although this video hasn't had as many requests as some of my previous videos, I myself find this whole thing to be very interesting and wanted to dive into its impact a bit more. You guys wanted it? Now you have it. Here we go. So what in the hell is the 1,000-degree knife? Well, it's a 1,000-degree knife. If you've spent any amount of time on YouTube lately, it more than likely tried to stuff one of the 1,000-degree knife videos down your throat via the YouTube suggested videos. Now, some people love these videos, finding them satisfying, entertaining, and sometimes educational, while other people really hate the videos and see them as mindless trash content that only further displays some of the problems YouTube has with its algorithm. Their problem with the algorithm is that it's unfair to have content like this come to the top and be suggested to everybody, while other videos that have a lot more time and creativity put into them have a hard time finding any audience at all. So what's all the fuss about? Well, the trend revolves around the YouTube channel Mr. Gear. The videos that the channel uploads all follow the same theme. A knife is heated until it reaches 1,000 degrees, or until it's glowing red, which means it's pretty damn hot. After it's hot as hell, it then cuts through various objects, always resulting in the same outcome, which is oddly satisfying. Now, I can see why some people love these videos, but I can also see why others are annoyed that YouTube is pushing it so hard. I know what you're thinking. Just because YouTube is pushing the videos, people are mad. It all sounds really stupid and petty, but the thing is, YouTube is really pushing the videos. Like pushing them so hard, they may get a hemorrhoid. Damn, did I take it too far again? My bad, my bad. Let me show you guys some mind-blowing stats so you can better understand what I'm talking about. In the last month, the channel has gained nearly 2 million subscribers. That is ridiculous. It takes most channels years to obtain even half that amount, and the views within that time frame are crazy as well. If you take a look at the stats of the channel, you can see just how successful it's become. Bravo, bravo. Seriously, I always applaud others being able to become successful. The videos obviously appeal to somebody. And you know that old saying, don't hate the player, hate the game. Oh, my bad. I meant to say, don't hate the player, hate the game. I forgot that you have to say player with an A instead of an ER for it to make sense. So that's kind of the scenario that we find ourselves in. The game in which people are hating is the game of YouTube, which can make or break your channel by the way its algorithm works and the videos it suggests to viewers. And boy oh boy, has YouTube been suggesting these videos to viewers. Because of all the hype surrounding the genre of video, other YouTubers have begun to parody the videos in humorous ways, becoming a type of challenge in the process.
Session, bro.
Yoshi!
Oh, nothing like a good amiibo. There's gonna be so many nerds getting pissed off that I couldn't even afford an amiibo.
Oh, but the fun doesn't stop there. Because the 1000-degree knife videos have been so widely spread and suggested to everybody and their mother, brother, sister, and pet poodle, it has naturally begun to be used within memes, both photo and video-based. The photo-based memes often portray the knife as being an ultimate weapon that can defeat nearly all challengers, much like it does in the Mr. Gear videos. While the video-based versions of the meme are... You know what? Let's let the examples do the talking.
I'd like a
glowing 1000-degree knife.
About... this high. Okay, coming right up. I'm a real villain.
So there you have it. The 1000-degree knife started off as a controversial genre of video that YouTube has been stuffing down people's throats and has begun to evolve into memes that parody the amazing powers the knife seems to have. But hey, that's the internet for you, and on the internet, memes are king. Thank you all so very much for watching. Make sure to subscribe so you can catch my next video and stay up to date on all your favorite memes. Who knows, you may learn about a meme you never knew about before. I'll catch you beautiful people next time. Hey there, internet, and welcome to Behind the Meme, where we take a look at the meaning and the origin of your favorite memes and trends. Today we have a look at, I'll take two number nines. Recently, I had an overwhelming amount of requests for what people were calling the GTA number 9 meme. Now, of course, I know what GTA is, but I had no clue to what two number 9s was. But with the increase of comments requesting a video on the topic, I knew I was about to find out. As always, thank you all so very much for your comments. Keep them coming. You wanted it, now you have it. Here we go. I'll have two number nines, also known as Big Smoke's Order, refers to a line of dialogue said by a character named Big Smoke in the critically acclaimed 2004 video game Grand Theft Auto San Andreas. When this game first came out, it was a pretty big deal. The map was gigantic compared to other games of the era. My brother and myself were amazed with the gameplay of this GTA and sunk countless hours into playing it. And we weren't the only ones either. The game has sold over 27 million copies since its release and has been well received by all critics. Except for the version on Xbox. I don't know what happened there. The crazy thing is that even though this game was unbelievable back in the day, the newest Grand Theft Auto is mind-blowing compared to older variations. But back to two number nines. Big Smoke is a high-ranking gang member in the game who's an antagonist to main character CJ. Big Smoke was voiced by actor Clifton Powell, who is notable for having appearances in a couple of Ice Cube's Friday movies. During a mission in the game called Drive Thru, the player is met with a cutscene in which the characters are in a car ordering some fast food from the drive-thru of a Cluckin' Bell restaurant. And, well, let me show you what happens.
Hey, I'll take a number nine, fat boy.
Give me a number nine, just like his.
Let me get a number six with extra dip.
I'll have two number nines, a number nine large, a number six with extra dip, a number seven, two number 45s, one with cheese, and a large soda.
As you can tell, Big Smoke is, big boned. The other men order a normal amount of food while he orders a total of 7 meals, an absurd amount of food for any human, even if that human is, big. Many people just chuckled and laughed at the occurrence when they played the game, but over a decade later, the internet would take the humorous line and turn it into a meme. The line of dialogue first became a copypasta. People would take the absurd and random quote and post it in forums or comment sections online, leaving many people confused and speechless, wondering where the hell it came from and what it all meant. But since then, it has evolved from the basic text of copypastas to be used in various video edits where it is often mixed with other popular memes. There are literally dozens upon dozens of different edits using Big Smoke's order. Here is just a handful of some notable examples. What was I saying? Right, the examples.
Give me
two number nines, a number nine large, a number six with extra dip.
I have
two number nine.
I have a
number nine large. Number six with extra. I'll have two number nines, a number nine large, a number six with extra dip.
While researching this topic, I even found a video of some guys ordering Big Smoke's order at a real McDonald's, which I thought was pretty funny, although I don't think the workers felt the same way.
Thank you for choosing our McDonald's. Can I take your order?
I take two number nines, a number nine large, a number six with extra dip, a number seven, two number 45s, one with cheese, and a large soda. Okay?
Hold on.
I'm talking to you.
Now, I couldn't find any detailed information to why people started to use this as a meme, but it's kinda obvious. This is one of those memes that often leaves people confused with how absurd it is. It has become an inside joke that has recently began to spread from person to person. There is no rhyme or reason to why people started to use the quote, other than random absurd insanity, of course. Sometimes that's the only reason needed to create a meme. When you have a line of dialogue from a game that's over 10 years old that is already strange and you put it in a random spot on the internet that makes it even stranger, it's all the elements needed to make a classic meme. So there you have it. Two Number Nine started off as a line of dialogue uttered by a character from an old video game and has found new life in modern times in the weird and wacky world of memes. But hey, that's the internet for you, and on the internet, memes are king. Thank you all so very much for watching. Make sure to subscribe so you can catch my next video and stay up to date on all your favorite memes. Who knows, you may learn about a meme you never knew about before. I'll catch you guys next time.
Extra dip.
Hello, internet, and welcome to Behind the Meme, where we take a look at the meaning and the origin of your favorite memes and trends. Today we have a look at Salt Bae. Thank you all so very much for suggesting this topic. This one blew up and got pretty big this past week, but when I first saw it, I thought I may be too late to make a video on the subject. But then I saw that I still had people requesting it in my comment section, so I knew that I had to get it done. You guys wanted it, now you have it. Here we go. So what exactly is Salt Bae? Well, before I can explain, I must first ask you a couple questions to make sure you want to proceed with this video. Question number one, do you like food? I'm pretty sure the answer is yes. I mean, unless you're anorexic or something, in which case you should call this number. Seriously. Question number two, do you like porn? Now, I know damn well the answer to that is a definite yes. Well, lucky for you, if you said yes to those two questions, you are going to love Salt Bae. Let me show you why. Whoa, wrong video. This isn't that type of channel. I meant to play this clip right here. Sorry, vegetarians. Salt Bae refers to the nickname given to a Turkish chef named Nurset Gökçe. You know what? I'm sorry. I tried. Nurset became famous after he posted a video of himself preparing a steak and sprinkling salt on it in a very unique manner on January 7th, 2017. That video captivated the world and caused hashtag Salt Bae to trend worldwide. Within a few days of posting the video, it had amassed over 2 million views. That's a lot of views. Now, earlier in this video, when I was talking about porn, you may have thought to yourself that I was taking it a bit too far and over exaggerating. It's like, how is Salt Bae similar to porn? Because he's filmed more than just the original video. Have a look at this video right here. Come on, I can't be the only one who sees the connections. He is taking it to the brink of porn without it being considered porn. Being extra sensual with that big, thick meat of his. Damn it, that came out the wrong way. I meant to say with his juicy slab of beef. Damn, that didn't sound good either. With his non-sexual steak. There. Penis. Damn it! After the popularity of the initial videos, Salt Bae began to appear in various memes that often utilized his attractiveness or the way he sprinkled the salt in comedic ways. Not only did he appear in memes, but people also created parody videos imitating Salt Bae's original video. Now, after all the excitement from his videos, many people were left wanting to know more information about Nurset. Well, I learned a couple of interesting things while researching this topic. He happens to be the owner of the Nusret Steakhouse restaurants in Turkey and Dubai. Sorry, ladies. This image was posted to his Instagram account with him and what appears to be his 9 children. Yes, I said 9 children. The rough translation to the text accompanied with the image is, "The man who does not spend time with his family is not a real man." So I'm guessing that at least one of these kids is his. Maybe not all 9 of them, maybe there's a few nieces and nephews, but at least one of these kids is his. The point that I'm trying to make is he's doing a lot more with his meat than cooking it. Hey, anybody? You get it? You know, meat, you know, kids, no? So there you have it. Salt Bae started off as a chef with some style who enjoyed posting videos online before turning into an instant celebrity that people seem to be extremely fascinated with. But hey, that's the internet for you, and on the internet, memes are king. Ga-ga-ga. Thank you all so very much for watching. Make sure to subscribe so you can catch my next video and stay up to date on all your favorite memes. Who knows, you may learn about a meme you never knew about before. I'll catch you beautiful people next time. Hey now, internet, and welcome to Behind the Meme, where we take a look at the meaning and the origin of your favorite memes and trends. Today we have a look at the B-movie script. Now, I thought this meme was dead and over with, so I was shocked to see many of my viewers in the last couple videos request this topic. I was even more shocked to see that not only was the meme not dead, but it was trending higher than it ever had. So I knew that I had to start making the video that you guys wanted to see. Thank you all so very much for your suggestions. Keep them coming. Who knows, your comment may be the next video. You wanted it, now you have it. Here we go. So some of you may be confused with this topic. If you're new to the world of memes or just a part-time meme lover, you may be shocked to hear that the script to the animated film The Bee Movie is a meme. You know, the 2007 family film about bees starring Jerry Seinfeld and Renee Zellweger. Wait, that's what Renee Zellweger looks like now? What the hell happened?
I don't understand.
But don't worry, if you didn't see the movie, you didn't miss much. It's just a movie in which the plot of the film revolves around a bee who attempts to sue the human race for our treatment of bees and stealing their honey, all while falling in love with the human himself. Yeah, I couldn't make that shit up even if I wanted to. But to be fair, if you didn't see the film, that doesn't mean you can't be a fan of it. In fact, that's what this video is all about. Since the film's initial release, the movie script has become a popular meme online, first gaining a following on Tumblr with many users posting the various ways they are able to incorporate the text in ironic and funny ways. But eventually, the use of the script spread across the internet, being used in various humorous and bizarre ways. The script is what is known as a copypasta, most commonly used in shitposting, which is typically when people attempt to derail a forum post or online conversation by leaving a comment that has nothing to do with the subject at hand. In this case, people would post the entirety of the script when the original topic had nothing to do with it, leaving many people confused and wondering what the hell just happened, and the others who are in on the joke amused by the action. But since the original posting of the B-movie script copypastas, the script has been used in popular videos, one of which is a video where the entire script is read by YouTuber Brent Daniel in his epic, buttery, smooth voice.
According to all known laws of aviation, there is no way a bee should be able to fly. Its wings are too fat to get its fat little body off the ground. The bee, of course, flies anyway.
That video has gained over 400,000 views. Now this is where it gets even stranger. The Bee Movie has also been made into other video memes. Every type of popular edit you can imagine has been made using the Bee Movie. Of course, we have the entire Bee Movie, but instead of the regular voice actors, all the voices are replaced with Brent Daniels reading, which I have to admit I found to be pretty clever and funny.
Barry, breakfast is ready. Arming. Hang on a second. Hello, Barry, Adam?
And of course we have the Bee Movie trailer, but every time somebody says the word bee, the trailer speeds up and finishes before continuing back at the spot it was at before speeding up.
Humans have misunderstood them and feared them. Now, one bee. In a turtleneck sweater is gonna change everything.
And of course, we have the entire Bee Movie played at faster speed, condensing the film into 3 minutes. At least now we can all say we've seen the movie. That video has gained over 770,000 views since Halloween of 2016. 770,000, you guys. It's official, the internet is a weird place. And these are just a few of the handful of notable examples of the Bee Movie memes. They go on and on and on and on. The reason behind all this absurd insanity is simple. It's absurd and insane. Two characteristics that memes, especially ironic memes, often thrive on. And to take a movie that's already ridiculous and edit it to be more ridiculous equals meme heaven. But hey, that's the internet for you, and on the internet, memes are king. Thank you all so very much for watching. Make sure to subscribe so you can catch my next video and stay up to date on all your favorite memes. Who knows, you may learn about a meme you never knew about before. I'll catch you guys next time.
according to all known laws of aviation. There is no way a should be able to fly its wings are too small to get its fat little body off the ground.
You know, no two people are like each other, so don't be a lookalike copying another, unless, of course, you're copying me, because that gives you individuality.
Nice, too, but back to the matter at hand. So what do you say? Are you back in the band?
Well, maybe if I can find my old leather.
Dude, we're getting the band back together.
Hello, Internet, and welcome to Behind the Meme. Today we have a look at What in Tarnation. Thank you so very much to each and every single one of my amazing viewers who suggested a video on this very topic. I appreciate you guys taking time out of your day to request a future video, so make sure to let me know what you would like to see next, and maybe I'll be able to make it happen. You guys wanted it, now you have it. Here we go. Lately, the What in Tarnation memes have been all over social media, but what if I told you that the memes date back hundreds of years? That would be pretty weird, right? Well, they do, and it is pretty weird. Let me explain. So what in the hell is What in Tarnation? Well, ironically, that question is kinda what it is. You see, What in Tarnation is an older saying that is often associated with the southern states of America. In different regions of the country, there are various words and sayings that people use that originate from those places. For example, I was born and raised in California, and hella use the word hella, like hella often. Half the time I can't even help it, it's just a part of my speech and who I am because of where I'm from. Like most regional slang, it is a reflection of the mentality of its origins. And things like this exist almost everywhere. Different regions have various words, phrases, and slang that they use that originate from that specific area, but eventually spread to other regions with time. The southern states of the USA are typically more rural and calm compared to what the East and West have going on with their big cities, dense populations, and faster pace of life. Southern states are often filled with farms, open land, a slow, calm pace of life, and people who are mannered and often religious. In fact, the southern states are often referred to as the Bible Belt due to how important religion is to that area of the country. They basically go to church as often as I go to RedTube. I meant to say YouTube. Yeah, I meant to say YouTube. So What in Tarnation starts to make more sense when you consider these aspects of the South. Tarnation is defined as damnation or damned, but as you can see here, when it is used as a euphemism like it is in the example we're looking at today, it translates to hell. So instead of saying what in the hell is this, or what in the hell is going on, or why in the hell is my girlfriend laughing at me when I'm naked, people in the South would say tarnation instead of saying hell, which to some people who are very religious consider a swear word. If they think hell is a bad word, they would have a heart attack if they heard some of the kids I knew when growing up. So what in tarnation was an older phrase that was often used in the South as a way to express confusion or slight anger. I first became aware of the phrase thanks to television and film, where it is often used and accompanied with a southern accent to help add color to characters. You see, in storytelling, when you hear an accent and a phrase that is associated with a certain region of the world, it says a lot about the character in question without actually having to say anything at all. Now, sometimes these traits and characteristics become stereotypes, meaning that they don't hold true to everybody but can usually be accurately associated with at least a portion of the group. One of the stereotypes for certain southern states is cowboy fashion, mainly in Texas. And if we've learned anything from the classic cowboy movies, it's that you can't be a cowboy if you don't have a cowboy hat, or the knack for disappointing your fans season after season. In early January of 2017, an image of a Shiba Inu dog wearing a stylish cowboy hat appeared on Tumblr with the classic phrase in the lower left corner of the image. The picture gained a ton of comments and attention before eventually spreading to Twitter, where it began to become a reaction image to accompany various southern influenced tweets, often adding humorous context to the original image and gaining a ton of likes and retweets in the process. Naturally, the internet took the cowboy hat wearing dog image to the next level with various parodies that follow the format of using the cowboy hat, but replacing the dog with various other subjects, as well as replacing what in tarnation with different words that follow the format of what in blank nation that have ties to the new subject in some way, allowing for nearly endless possibilities and humorous parodies. So there you have it. What in tarnation started off as an older saying that is associated with the southern states of the US before becoming a new meme that is remixed in a variety of clever and humorous ways. But hey, that's the internet for you, and on the internet, memes are king. Thank you all so very much for watching. Make sure to subscribe so you can catch my next video and stay up to date on all your favorite memes and trends. Who knows, you may learn about something you never knew about before. I'll catch you beautiful people next time.
Woo, the tarnation is going on in this nation.
Hello, internet, and welcome to Behind the Meme, where we take a look at the meaning and the origin of your favorite memes and trends. Today we have a look at Brother May I Have Some Oats. I want to give a huge thank you to each and every single one of my viewers who left comments letting me know that this was a video that they were interested in seeing. Boy, did you guys let me know. This past week, it seemed like every other comment was requesting this video. So let me know what you want to see next, and maybe I'll be able to make it happen. You guys wanted it, now you have it. Here we go. Now, this meme has seemed to come out of nowhere and spread at an amazingly fast rate over the last couple of weeks. But what if I told you that the meme started long before that? Would you believe me? Well, what if I told you that it first started in the 1850s? You know, the 1850s, back when ladies' fashion looked like this. Back when you were considered a slut if you showed your ankle. But I'm jumping ahead just a little bit too quickly. First, let me explain what the meme's all about. Brother May I Have Some Oats refers to an expression that is associated with a picture of two pigs feasting on what is assumed to be oats. You know, the stuff that sometimes comes in that container with that creepy guy in the weird hat on the cover of it. That guy that looks like if you happen to encounter him in a dark alley on a cold winter night, you may be leaving the alley without your wallet and virginity. Although I don't know if pigs eat the same type of oats as humans, but for the sake of my dumb joke, let's just say that they do. The meme first originated on Twitter on October 10th, 2016, when Twitter user @Markiana simply posted the image along with the caption, "Brother, may I have some oats?" Although his O's had those two little dot things above them. Listen, I'm not the smartest guy in the world. I have no clue to what those dot things are called. I'm just the guy that makes YouTube videos about memes. You expect me to know? Okay, there, they're called umlauts. I guess they make letters sound differently, so like I guess his post kind of sounded like, "Bruda, may I have some oats?" I'm trying to be funny, it's not working, just don't judge me. Over the next few months, the post gained a ton of retweets and likes, which helped spread the popularity of the meme. Eventually, it spread to other sites like Tumblr and 4chan, where people began to elaborate on the story a bit more, usually with classy and elegant wording. These expansions of the meme have even begun to be used within videos here on YouTube.
"Sorry, brother, I've already begun eating the oats.
I have very few oats, brother. I must procure yours.
Sorry, brother, but you may have nuts."
Since the original meme, the pigs have also been used in a variety of ways, both video and picture form, spreading far beyond the original tweet and into something that I can't even attempt to explain. Like, my best explanation to this meme is two simple words: the crazy ass internet. Damn it, that's more than two words, isn't it? The original painting of the pair of pigs is called A Pair of Pigs. Are you serious? Clever and original title, you guys. Come on, you can do better than that. That's like calling the Mona Lisa a lady, or this painting right here, a rapist. Like, I guess it's accurate titles, but come on, you can be a little more creative. The painting is an oil on canvas piece of art that was first created in 1850 by an unknown artist. For all we know, it was Da Vinci or Banksy, or maybe even our Lord and Savior, Bob Ross. I'm not sure if the dates line up, but who knows? So there you have it. Brother May I Have Some Oats started off as a piece of art that is over 160 years old and has turned into a new form of art we call a meme 2 centuries later. You gotta admit, the world is a weird ass place. But hey, that's the internet for you, and on the internet, memes are king. Thank you all so very much for watching. Make sure to subscribe so you can catch my next video and stay up to date on all your favorite memes. Who knows, you may learn about a meme you never knew about before. I'll catch you beautiful people next time.
Time to rise and shine.
Hello, Internet, and welcome to Behind the Meme. Today we have a look at...
Hey, this is Library.
This video was by far the best thing I saw online this week. I see some pretty interesting things on the internet pretty often. So I think I'm gonna start a new series where I showcase some of these funny, random, and strange things. They may not always be memes, but they'll always be worth your time. Luckily, this video has also started to become a meme, so it's the perfect topic to start on. Thank you so very much to everybody who suggested I make a video on this topic. As many of you may know, various protests have erupted across America this week. I think they're protesting a rise in the price of Fruity Pebbles or because they finally realized King of the Hill was canceled. I've also heard some people say it has something to do with some orange guy and some weird hair. I don't know. I don't know exactly what's going on. But what I do know is that a portion of the population is mad while the other part just doesn't care and are trying to live their life and move on. Well, there is various times when those two worlds collided this past week, and one of the situations happened to be captured on film and proved to be rather humorous. You see, there are these places called libraries. Their purpose is to house books for people to take and read. Books that are made out of paper. I know, weird, right? But back in the day, old people like me had no other choices. So a library card and physical books made out of paper were the only option. Now you young whippersnappers have tablets and Kindles and Pornhub and X-Hamster and RedTube. Wait, I'm getting off track again. The point that I'm trying to make is libraries are a place to read books in peace and quiet.
Shh, sorry. In fact, being quiet is one of the notorious rules of the library.
No talking! This is a library! It must be quiet! People are trying to study!
So what happens when you have a library located at the University of Washington full of young idiots who think they are making a difference by being loud and obnoxious and for some reason see logic in protesting in a school library with no political figures around while everybody else is trying to study? Well, you get one of the best videos ever, or at least from this week.
This is library.
Now, when I first saw this video, it made me so happy. I just love the way that it played out. You have these annoying people chanting that they have the power, yet a single man was able to silence the ignorance, even if only for that moment in time. This guy made his point and became an internet hero in the process. After the video was posted to YouTube, it began to spread and become popular due to people admiring the humor and irony of the situation. Various memes have even begun to be created involving the man and the video.
This is library.
The YouTube channel Cool Songs even created a song remix of the video, making it more awesome in the process.
Hey! 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 This is library.
Now, on a more serious note, the guy in the video has an obvious accent.
This is library.
So I'm going to assume he's from a different country, meaning he has more than likely worked his ass off to make it to the college level at a university in a different country. He is making the most of his time and spending it in the library to study and better himself. Then you have these other people who are truly accomplishing nothing but disrupting others, being bullies in the process. I gotta give some props to the dude to stand up to such a big group. group of people like he did. That takes some major balls. No! The dude just wanted to be left alone to study. We can all have our different views and opinions on things, but don't push them onto other people. That's when it becomes annoying. So there you have it. Hey, 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 this is a library. Started off as words from a guy just trying to study before eventually turning him into an internet badass. But hey, that's the internet for you, and on the internet, memes are king. Thank you all so very much for watching. Make sure to subscribe so you can catch my next video and stay up to date on all your favorite memes and trends. Who knows, you may learn about something you never knew about before. I'll catch you beautiful people next time.
This is library. This is library. This is library. Error bells is it. Error bells is it. Error bells is it.
Hello, internet, and welcome to Behind the Meme. Today we have a look at Darude Sandstorm. Now, this is one of those classic memes that has been requested on my channel since I first made it. I knew that one day I would have to make a video on this topic, and today is that day. Thank you all so very much for all your comments. They truly help shape this channel. Let me know what you would like to see next, and maybe I'll be able to make it happen. You guys wanted it, now you have it. Here we go. Go.
Leave It to Timmy is filmed in front of a live studio audience.
Has this ever happened to you? Gee willikers, I sure do love this YouTube video and I really like that song that they used. I wish I knew what it was so I can listen to it on my own time. Maybe if I ask the kind people in the comment section, they'll know and help me out. Hey fellas, what is the song in the video? Let's see, they said Darude Sandstorm KYS. That must be a new band. Darude Sandstorm. It must be Darude Sandstorm. The people on the internet sure are kind and helpful.
Oh, Timmy, you naive, gullible dumbass.
Okay, guys, I'll be honest. Not long ago, I was Timmy. I was looking for the title of a song that I heard in a video, so I decided to ask the comment section. Well, I was greeted with a ton of responses, all saying the same thing, Darude Sandstorm. So naturally, I typed that into YouTube so I could listen to the song that I enjoyed once more. But there was only one problem. Instead of the song I was expecting to hear, I got this. I was pretty disappointed. Not because the song was bad or anything, but because I was punked. Wait, is punk still a relevant term? Is Ashton Kutcher even still alive? Oh, right, I forgot. He won the vagina lottery. What I'm trying to say is I was disappointed because I was trolled. I soon realized that Darude Sandstorm was an online joke that had overtaken not only the comment sections of YouTube, but also the rest of the internet. If you decided to ask what the title of a song was, the answer was Darude Sandstorm. If you wanted to know how somebody was doing, Darude Sandstorm. If you wanted to ask how is it possible that I Justine is so hot, Darude Sandstorm. Darude Sandstorm became the answer to everything. But how did this happen? It all seems pretty strange because after all, the Sandstorm song was originally released in 1999. It's most likely older than most of you watching this video right now, which reminds me how old I am. I mean, in 1999, I was watching Howard Stern and pretending to be Stone Cold Steve Austin. You see, the song has the ability to make a person feel pumped up and ready to go, which is the perfect feeling if you're about to compete in some type of competition, which is exactly what happened. You see, there's a game called League of Legends that is very popular and competitive. In fact, it's very competitive, to the point that there are professional players who have won a lot of money playing the game. And when I say lots of money, I mean hundreds of thousands of dollars. The point that I'm trying to make is that people take the game very seriously, so being able to make yourself feel pumped up while you're playing the game is a valuable thing. And Sandstorm is the perfect song. In 2013, a League of Legends player known as the Odd One was hosting a Twitch live stream while Darude Sandstorm was playing in the background. This song got him energetic and pretty pumped up as he made some key plays for his team.
Darude Sandstorm. Sorry, babe. Just got Daruded.
The video was submitted to the League of Legends subreddit, where it received a ton of attention and helped Darude's sandstorm spread. Now, because the League of Legends community is so big, it easily spread beyond that base community to other areas of the internet, where it has become the joke we know it as today. Darude's sandstorm has even evolved to have an ironic fandom that refers to the song as the greatest song of all time. But it's no Justin Bieber baby. Sorry guys, the best song of all time title is already taken. Since the song has become a meme, its popularity has spread in other ways as well, with numerous interesting covers being created to capitalize on its popularity. So there you have it. Sandstorm started off as a song from a Finnish music producer named Darude before becoming an internet joke that we have all come across during our time online. But hey, that's the internet for you, and on the internet, memes are king. Thank you all so very much for watching. Make sure to subscribe so you can catch my next video and stay up to date on all your favorite memes and trends. Who knows, you may learn about something you never knew about before. I'll catch you beautiful people next time. Hello, internet, and welcome to Behind the Meme. Today we have a look at RollSafe. As always, thank you all so very much for leaving comments letting me know what video you are interested in seeing next. It means the world to me to get the support from this little family we have created together. You guys make me proud and excited to make videos, so make sure to let me know what you would like to see next and maybe I'll be able to make it happen. You guys wanted it, now you have it. Here we go. Now, first things first, this meme is a little confusing because what in the hell do you call it? Well, I guess that's kind of a dumb question because by now you saw the title of this video, so you know that it's referred to as the RollSafe meme. But many people have referred to it as the black guy pointing at his head meme, the life hack guy, or even the you can't X if you Y guy. It has quite a few names. It's kind of obvious to why it has multiple names other than RollSafe. First off, he's a black guy pointing at his head. I mean, what else would you call it? Wait, is it okay to say black guy nowadays? I'm not sure anymore. I don't want the PC police to come get me, so, to be safe, let's say that he's a man, pointing at his head with, more melanin in his skin than a person with less melanin, making his skin tone darker. There. Now the PC police can leave me alone and go back to bothering PewDiePie or JonTron. The other name that the meme is commonly referred to at times is the can't X if you Y guy. That trend started due to the common formula in which the memes follow. You see, the picture of the man shows him pointing at his head in a way that indicates thinking or using the brain. So the picture has started to be accompanied with text that follows the can't X if you Y formula in comedic ways, as well as other ways that don't always follow the formula directly. Sometimes having a smartass tone and other times supplying pieces of knowledge that can serve as life hacks. But to be honest, it's kind of hard to classify the tone of these memes because they're always being used in different ways. The meme has even adapted to portray other people or characters with jokes that relate directly to them. One of the very first memes to use the image came in November of 2016 from the @FootyHumor Twitter account that used it in a way that provided a clever trick. A trick that involved intentionally making your girlfriend mad so she leaves you alone and you can continue to play video games. Which I would totally use if I played video games, or if I had a girlfriend, or even a friend, or anybody who loved me, or just somebody who cared about me even mildly. It's times like this that I start to wonder what I'm doing with my life, where I'm going, whether or not I'm headed in the right direction. I wonder if what I'm doing matters, or if anybody even cares.
knowing that with each passing day I take a step closer to my inevitable demise.
Where was I?
Since that initial tweet, the image has begun to be used more often in 2017, with various tweets appearing on Twitter and gaining likes and retweets, helping spread the use of the meme in the process. Now in February, the meme has become very popular on various social media platforms, with many people using the meme but not knowing the name RollSafe. Now, who in the hell is RollSafe, you may be asking yourself? Where did it come from, you may be asking yourself? Are you going to explain it, you may be asking yourself? Will that rash on my no-no spot ever go away after that drunken night in Las Vegas with those two little people and that donkey, you may be asking yourself? I mean, what? I didn't say that, it's not me. Rhys Simpson, aka RS, aka RollSafe, is a character played by actor Kaori Iwumi in the web series #Hood Documentary. In the very first episode titled Happy Belated, RollSafe is meeting a girl for lunch for her birthday, and while being interviewed by the documentary crew, he delivers the iconic image after informing the crew that he likes the girl he is meeting because she has a good head and brains.
And she's got a good head on her. Great head. Yeah, man, I think Rachel's beautiful because she's got good brains.
Now, some of you may understand why RollSafe was pointing to his head. You guys know what's up. But some of you guys who may be a bit younger may not understand. You see, he was pointing to his head because what he was telling the crew had two meanings and he wanted you to think about it. The girl is smart and has a good head and brains, but she also has a good head and brains, if you know what I mean. Let's just say that head and brain are slang terms used for, something else. So there you have it. RollSafe has gone from being a character in a web series who enjoys girls with good head and brains, and has become a meme that shares the knowledge we didn't know we needed to know. But hey, that's the internet for you, and on the internet, memes are king. Thank you all so very much for watching. Make sure to subscribe so you can catch my next video and stay up to date on all your favorite memes and trends. Who knows, you may learn about something you never knew about before. I'll catch you beautiful people next time. Woo. What happens in Vegas doesn't always stay in Vegas. Hello, internet, and welcome to Behind the Meme. Today we have a look at Savage Babies. Thank you so very much to each and every single one of my amazing viewers who take time out of their day to watch my previous videos and also leave comments suggesting a topic for a new one. You guys keep me motivated and mean the world to me. Let me know what you would like to see next and maybe I'll be able to make it happen. You guys wanted it, now you have it. Here we go. Now, the typical definition of savage relates to violence. An animal or individual that acts primitive and uncivilized, kind of like somebody we all know. But also nowadays, some people use the term to describe something that is cool or crazy in a good way. Urban Dictionary has some definitions and examples that can explain it just a little bit better than I can. So now that we understand the word a little bit better, it leaves us with savage babies. What in the hell is a savage baby? At first, I thought that maybe it might be that one kid who smokes 40 cigarettes a day. That's pretty savage. Or maybe it's some kid who's already in a gang and doing crazy stuff like drive-bys on a tricycle or robbing Girl Scouts. I don't know, something kind of like that, but no. Much like my decision to eat Mexican food last night, I was wrong. These, my friend, are the savage babies. Now, at first, it doesn't make much sense. These cute little animated babies are savage? They don't seem to fit either definition of the word. Well, it's a thing called irony. Ask Alanis Morissette about it. But believe it or not, savage babies is not the original name of these weird-looking babies. All I'm saying is if my kid had that head-to-body proportion, I may consider putting that alien up for adoption. But I'm getting off topic. The original name of the babies are Zool Babies. They're a part of a video series from the YouTube channel Video Guy on 3D Rhymes Nursery Rhymes for Children. That's a mouthful.
That's what she said!
The channel is ran by the company Video Gyan, which is based in India and solely produces content geared towards children learning through media as stated here on their website. Before the 3D Savage Babies came around, the earlier videos on the channel were more so 2D based, kinda like this.
Miss Polly had a dolly who was sick, sick, sick. So she called for the doctor to be quick, quick, quick. The doctor came with his bag and his hat, and he knocked at the door with a rat-a-tat-a-tat.
You stupid kid, that's a doll. They don't get sick, they don't have a pulse, they're not humans. You're wasting the doctor's time. He probably went to medical school for like a decade so he can have a nice bank account, a nice house, a nice car, and most likely a wife who is 20 years younger than him with fake breasts. He didn't go to school for all that time to be wasting his time on a kid who can't comprehend that dolls aren't living things and they can't get sick. Calm down, it's just a video. Get a grip on yourself. Eventually, the 3D video starring the Zool Baby started to appear on the channel, upping the production value of it in the process. Let me give you guys a taste of the types of videos they make using the Savage Babies. Quick question, why is nobody calling CPS on that mom for letting her kids ride their bikes in the middle of a busy street? The good news is she won't be having to call the doctor much longer because her kids will be dead. That video, which was the very first example of Zool Babies, was uploaded to YouTube in August of 2015. Which brings us to the Savage Babies meme. The meme's format is pretty simple. You take the original Zool Babies video and distort the audio until it becomes ear rape, and then give it an ironic, exaggerated title for comedic purposes. First being done by YouTuber Chopping Boss, who titled his upload the most savage babies in human history, creating the name of the meme in the process. Since then, various examples have been created following the same format of distorted audio with exaggerated titles, like this video right here titled Savage Babies Cause 9/11, or this video right here titled Savage Babies Murder Each Other. So there you have it. Savage Babies started off as strange videos for children to learn from, I guess, and have evolved into a meme with loud audio and humorous titles for everybody to enjoy. But hey, that's the internet for you, and on the internet, memes are king. Thank you all so very much for watching. Make sure to subscribe so you can catch my next video and stay up to date on all your favorite memes and trends. Who knows, you may learn about something you never knew about before. I'll catch you beautiful people next time. Hello, internet, and welcome to Behind the Meme. Today we have a look at, why is the FBI here? Thank you so very much to each and every single one of my amazing viewers who suggested this video. Your comments help shape this channel and the videos that I make. So thank you for all your love and support. It means the world to me, and the world means a lot. You guys wanted it, now you have it. Here we go. The internet. It's a pretty cool place, right? I mean, aside from the selfies and annoying people and needless opinions and identity theft and Kardashian Instagrams, other than those things, it's pretty cool. It has more upsides than it does downsides. We now have the ability where we have every single piece of knowledge ever known to man at our fingertips. No need to go to the library, no need to pay attention in school. All we have to do is go to Google. Or Bing if you're one of those weird people. Simply type in any question or piece of information we are curious about, and in a matter of seconds we have our answer. When I'm curious about how to make a paper origami swan, bam, the internet has my back. When I wonder when those weird bread tie things were invented, bippity boppity boo, the internet comes through. 1952, by the way. When I wonder whether or not my penis will grow any more at my age, the internet has the answer, and sadly it is no. I guess 2 inches is gonna have to do. That last question I asked kinda leads us to the why is the FBI here meme. Be honest, how many times do you ask Google things you more than likely wouldn't want to admit to others. I'm gonna guess pretty often. We all do. Damn it, Frank. I don't know who you are, but I know damn well that there's a Frank out there watching this video right now acting like he doesn't Google kittens doing the Macarena dance. You know what? Kittens doing the Macarena dance was the first thing that came to my mind for some strange reason, but now I have to know whether or not there's a video of cat doing a Macarena dance. And the answer is yes, the internet never fails, but sometimes it tricks us. You see, many people feel that in this digital computer age, we have the ability to remain anonymous while online, which is a key reason to why there are so many trolls and lost morals when people interact with each other on the internet. But as we as a society have continued to evolve and adapt to this digital world, some of us tend to do or search for things online that could get us in a bit of trouble. Now, although many feel that they are safe because they are anonymous on the internet, time has shown that Big Brother is always watching. So those feelings of safety due to being anonymous are false. Just because things happen online does not mean we aren't held accountable for our actions. The Federal Bureau of Investigation, also known as the FBI, is the Domestic Intelligence and Security Service for the United States of America. Basically, when you do serious shit, you have to deal with the FBI, and at that point, you are effed. FBI. Nowadays, more and more crimes happen online, and when they do, you have to answer to the FBI. Thanks to various laws and political things that I'm too stupid to understand, legally the government can monitor our activities on the internet and there's not a damn thing we can do about it. But it's really not a bad thing. In fact, it has taken many bad people off the streets. It seems like almost every week the FBI raids the house of a person who has child porn. Good riddance. These people are sick and need to be arrested. Underage girls? Seriously? Sickos. Wait a second. Close one. Like I was saying, they are perverts. Arrest them. But child porn isn't the only thing that they monitor. Quick tip, be very careful with what you type into Google the next time you go shopping for a pressure cooker. A few wrong words could lead to the FBI knocking at your door. With all these elements at play, it was only a matter of time before the internet partook in some self-deprecating humor and made a meme out of the situation. First being created in February of 2017 by the Instagram profile Blaze It Memes, who posted a meme that portrayed quite a funny scenario. As you can see, he is currently on the Google website, and a few of his past searches, which are rather questionable, can be seen in the history. At the same time, his dad is texting him asking him why the FBI is at their house, indicating that due to his prior searches, he has been flagged by the FBI and a raid has occurred. In the following weeks, others created their own variations that added a little bit of extra humor to the images by searching for things that wouldn't necessarily trigger the FBI to raid your house like the more serious crimes would. The FBI element has also even begun to be remixed and changed in a variety of ways to add extra comedy to the punchline of the joke, resulting in a humorous and highly enjoyable meme, at least to me. So there you have it. Why is the FBI here? Started off as a question a concerned father may ask his son who is up to no good, before eventually becoming a humorous meme that parodies the consequences of crimes that are usually pretty serious. Wait, I need to search something real quick. Oh crap. But
freeze,
hey,
FBI,
that's
get on
the internet
floor,
for you, and on the
freeze,
internet, memes are king.
Freeze,
thank
FBI,
you all so very much for
floor.
Watching. Make sure to subscribe so you can catch my next video and stay up to date on all your favorite memes and trends. Who knows, you may learn about something you never knew about before. I'll catch you beautiful people next time.
The FBI agents, parts of the Bureau of Terrorism Task Force, NYPD, converged on that apartment building. Now the media had been knocking on her door since early this morning. In fact, we were here hours before police. Yeah.
Hello, internet, and welcome to Behind the Meme. Today we have a look at
Reese's Puffs, Reese's Puffs. Eat 'em up, beat 'em up, beat 'em up, beat 'em up.
Thank you so very much to each and every single one of my amazing viewers who took time out of their day to request this video. I appreciate you beautiful people so very much. Your comments and requests help shape this channel and the videos that I make, so make sure to let me know what you would like to see next and maybe I'll be able to make it happen. You guys wanted it, and some of you really really wanted it. I expect delivery of your child via UPS in no less than a week, Farbod. The clock is ticking. Now you have it. Here we go. Breakfast, the most important meal of the day. At least that's what I've always been told. But I used to skip breakfast constantly, and look at me now. I turned out just fine. Sure, I didn't finish fifth grade, and yeah, I've been arrested like a dozen times. But who needs a fifth grade education or freedom when you can sell your organs? It's like free money. God gave us two kidneys, two lungs, and two livers for a reason. Duh. But enough Winning. Talk about my entrepreneurial businesses. Let's get back to breakfast. A staple of breakfast has always been cereal. Well, at least since 1866, when some guy named James Caleb Jackson first invented it. Before that, people would eat boring stuff like toast, oatmeal, grapes. Boring. What's the fun in eating if you don't have the risk of catching diabetes? Now, for any of us who have been down the cereal aisle at the grocery store, one thing becomes apparent very quickly. Many cereals have an abundant amount of sugar to appeal to the taste buds of their primary demographic, which is kids. Why else do you think toys have been included with cereal since the early 1900s? Kids love toys. Why do you think almost every cereal mascot is a cartoon? Because kids love cartoons. And any professional pedophile will tell you that if there's one thing kids love more than toys and cartoons, it's candy. So in 1994, somebody who may or may not be a pedophile got the smart idea to combine what children loved most into one amazing product. Reese's Puffs cereal was invented, and every 90s kid went bananas. Reese's was one of the biggest names behind some of the most iconic candies, and General Mills was known for their popular cereals. It was a match made in breakfast heaven. Now let me ask you this question. As a company, what do you do to market your product to appeal to the younger demographic? That's right, rap commercials. Reese's. Now, there are numerous commercials that Reese's Puffs ran throughout its 23 years as a cereal, and a handful of them focused on spreading their message through hip-hop. But one in particular has seemed to catch the interest of the internet a bit more than the others.
Amazing things can happen when you taste Reese's Puffs.
Wow!
Chris, no more riding your bike to school. You'll be driven by chauffeur from now on.
Oh, and you can't go to the concert.
Yes!
So we're bringing it to you.
The commercial dates back to as early as 2006, but it's kind of hard to put an exact date to it. But I do know for sure it's prior to 2008 because the rap segment of the commercial was first uploaded to YouTube in March of 2008 on what appears to be one of the actor's YouTube accounts. A fellow who goes by the name of Terrence Washington, who is this actor right here. Now, the song would normally just be a piece of nostalgia for those from that era, but it happened to cross into current times when it was combined with the song Uptown Funk by Mark Ronson and Bruno Mars, thanks to the genius YouTuber Ash Cool Bro. Now, at first, that may sound like a strange combination. An old cereal commercial and a modern day song combined together? Well, surprisingly, it worked pretty well.
Eat 'em up, beat 'em up, beat 'em up, beat 'em up. I got Reese's Puffs in my bowl. Now my days on cruise control. I got Reese's Puffs in my bowl. And just like that, I'm on a roll. Reese's Puffs, Reese's Puffs. Peanut butter chocolate flavor. Reese's Puffs, Reese's.
But the one thing that made this remix song reach new heights of popularity goes by the name of Ian the Alien. iDubb celebrated reaching 100,000 subscribers by creating a special video for his viewers. A video that featured the now iconic segment of iDubbs in costume dancing to the catchy song.
Beat 'em up, beat 'em up, beat 'em up, beat 'em up. I got Reese's Puffs in my bowl. Now my day's on cruise control. I got Reese's Puffs in my bowl. And just like that, I'm on a roll. Reese's Puffs, Reese's Puffs. Peanut butter chocolate.
Since then, the popularity of the Reese's Puffs song has blown up, spreading far beyond its original commercial and demographic, with various remixes and uses of the song being created, shared, and enjoyed by many. So there you have it. What was once a simple cereal commercial from 10 years ago has been combined with new music and become a meme for a new generation. But hey, that's the internet for you, and on the internet, memes are king. Thank you all so very much for watching. Make sure to subscribe so you can catch my next video and stay up to date on all your favorite memes and trends. Who knows, you may learn about something you never knew about before. I'll catch you beautiful people next time.
and chop you too. You know how I do, that's what I wake up to. My Reese's Puffs inspired this rhyme. That peanut butter chocolate combination's on time. I got Reese's Puffs in my bowl. Nowadays on cruise control. I got Reese's Puffs in my bowl.